Hey, good evening. Good evening. Can everybody hear me? Okay. Get a couple more minutes and we'll get started. God is good. Amen. I know that everybody is in the midst of getting their Thanksgiving on and fixing all that good food and everything. I know in times past we haven't, sometimes we've had Bible study or not, but today I wanted to, it was on my heart that just want to share a couple things because it's vitally, to me, it's very, very important that we really take an opportunity to give God the praise and give him thanks for all that he has done for us, because he has done so, so much. He's done so much. If you just think about your life and where you were and where you are now, I can't tell you how you feel or what you should feel. That's a hard thing between you and between God. But I want to share something with you that God put upon my heart to share tonight, just for a few moments. If you would, Brother Titus, let me see. If you would open us in prayer, please.
Father, we come to you now thanking you for your goodness, Lord, your kindness, your mercy, and your grace.
Yes, Jesus.
Father, we thank you, Father, for opportunity to come via Zoom tonight, Lord, and praise your name, Lord, to worship your Father, to glorify your Lord simply because of who you are. Master, we pray that you would bless each and every participant tonight, Lord. Father, that you would bless the ones that's here, the ones that's on the way, Lord, the ones that would be here, but for whatever reason, Lord, can't make it tonight, Lord, we pray that you would bless them where they are, Lord. Father, we lift up Pastor Overall, his family to you, Lord. As he expounds on your word tonight, Lord, I pray for a fresh anointing to fall on him, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would fill him with Holy Ghost power tonight, Lord. That you would continue to mold and shape us, Lord, into the vessels that you've called us to be. Lord, as we study your word, Lord, we pray that we become more like you in every way, Lord, in the things that we say and the things that we do and the places we go and the way that we shine, Lord. Lord, allow us, Father, to be living vessels for your service tonight, Lord. Father, bless us as we study this word, Lord. We have so much to be thankful for, Lord, as we celebrate the season of Thanksgiving, Lord. Every day in our lives is Thanksgiving, Father, because we wake up thanking you. Father, we go to bed thanking you, Lord. All throughout the day, we're thanking you, Lord.
Yes,
Father, because you've been so good to us, Lord. Not just on one day, but every day, Lord.
Yes, Jesus.
Thank you, Father. Father, we pray that you, as we study this word, the Father, that the pastor has prepared for us, Lord, to help us, Father, to take this word, Lord, and apply it not only to our lives, Lord, but it will flow from us home to somebody else's life, Lord. Continue to bless us and keep us. For it's in the name of Jesus we ask these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. God is so good. Thank you, Brother Titus. You know something I just want to share? If you would look in your Bibles, please, to Luke, the 7th chapter, starting at 36th verse. And we just look at a little background concerning this situation. Jesus had done so many miracles. He had done an awesome miracle. And because he was always doing something. You know what I mean? He was always doing something. He was always about his Father's business. You know, and to me, if he was a kid, you know, nowadays, he'd have the reputation, you always up to something. You always got your hands in something. You always doing something. And usually a kid, if we're talking about a kid, just a boy, because a boy's always in the sun. You're talking about a boy, man. You're just like, man, dude, what are you doing? You're always doing something, man. Stop. But Jesus was doing something all the time. He didn't have idle hands, and he was always about his Father's business. Always. About his Father's business. And here he comes again doing something, right? Here he comes again. I want you to see this. Here he comes again doing something. He just got out of doing something. Now he's up into doing something else. He's always in a situation. And there's always an opportunity wherever he is. So if you look at the seventh chapter of Luke, the 36 to the 39, you see some background. He had just got through doing a wonderful work, just got through performing miracles, just got through dealing with the testimony concerning John the Baptist. And he had just got through, you know, as he was walking along, a Pharisee came to him and said, "Hey, Jesus, hey, man, look, I want you to come and dine at my house. I want you to come and dine at my house." Now, you got many of you have family members coming in and stuff to eat at your table and to dine at your table, or you may be going someplace, and then that's all good, and God's going to keep you because God is God, amen? And he goes to this Pharisee's house, and the Pharisee had already prepared everything for him in advance. And he comes in, and he's sitting there on the ground. You know, he didn't have a chair like we have a chair. He's sitting on the floor on the pillow with his feet behind me. And they begin to talk and begin to conversate like we would, you know, when we have family over and everything. He's making a little bit of small talk and just talking. And I can see the Pharisee begin to ask him certain things about the miracles, and they're talking about this and talking about that. And I'm not going to get into, thank you, Lord. I'm not going to get into to if the Pharisee was wanting to trick him or trap him and all this stuff, just for the sake of argument, that the Pharisee was seeking after Jesus. He wanted something from God. He had just seen all these mighty miracles and he wanted something. So he invited Jesus over. And they're sitting there and they're talking. And all of a sudden, this woman comes in. And it plainly says, according to the word of God, that she was a sinner. It does not say that she was saved. It does not say that she was forgiven. Because when Jesus forgave them, they were changed and life was changed. But it says plainly that she was a sinner. Now you got to get that. That she was a sinner. And the word of God says that she had this alabaster vial of, and it was full of precious ointment of perfume. And we know that other places in the Bible that says it was a very, very great price. It was very expensive. But she came and she stood behind Jesus. She didn't ask for permission. She stood behind him. She knelt down at his feet that was sticking out, and she began to cry, and she began to weep, and she began to, and the word of God says that she began to wash his feet with her tears and dry them with her hair. And as I was reading this, I could see her more and more. And I say, I don't know your situation. I don't know how you came up with Jesus. I don't know that. That's something between you and between God. All I can do is relate this to myself. But I have been to a point in my life where I needed God so desperately, and I couldn't get him. I couldn't get that place. I couldn't feel his presence. And you don't have to be in a place where you are backslidden to have that hunger and that thirst for God that you have got to have more. But she was in a state but just to keep it clear, I had been in a place where I had backslidden. I had been in a place where I had to have Jesus. I had to have his precious anointing and his power. When I mean his power, I'm not talking about raising the dead. I'm talking about the love of Almighty God that totally and changes and revolutionizes your life. I'm just talking about myself. So she was there, and I was reading this, I could see her crying as she began to sob, and all of a sudden it got a hold of her. And the enormity of her sin and her separation got a hold of it. That here is this love that is in front of me, but I cannot touch this love. I can't feel this love. I can't receive this love. And she's weeping more and more and more and more. And she begins to not just wipe his feet with her hair, but she begins to scrub his feet with her hair. And she begins to scrub. She begins to scrub. And she begins to scrub. She begins to scrub. And she's weeping and convulsing. And it's a matter of life and it's a matter of death. And I'm asking you to please open your hearts and receive this word that God has for you tonight. It's so important. She's there and she's beginning to weeping and she begins to convulsing. I want to talk to you a moment about the effects of trivial sin. The effects of trivial sin. As she is going through this, and the Pharisee who wanted Jesus to come into his house, wanted to sup with Jesus, wanted to sit down and fellowship with Jesus, as she's doing this, he takes notice of this. He takes notice. And how easy it is for the enemy to come in and to steal, kill, and destroy. To steal that hunger that he had, to steal that curiosity that he had, to steal that and rob him of that opportunity to receive what God had for him to receive. It is so easy to do. As I was sharing with Beverly, I was sharing with Beverly that we have got to make sure that we are focused, like when we went out last night and praised God. God bless everybody And the whole church, just God bless the whole church for chipping in and Brother Titus and everything. Praise God, you're a part of the church. Praise God, hallelujah. But as I was going and delivering meals and everything, and I pulled up to this one house, and this one house had a great big old pretty house, had a Escalade in the front, had a Mercedes in the back, had motorcycles, beautiful garage. And the enemy tried to rob me and get me to have an attitude. And the enemy said, why do they need a meal when they got all this? And I shared with Beverly, said, man, we got to make sure that we are focused on what God wants to do and not look on what the way things are perceived. Because my spirit man said, you know, hey, there may be one person in there, that senior that's in there may need just a seed, just a touch from God. And this is what they've been waiting on. And I had to shake that enemy off, and I went up and I said, hey, look, I'm looking for such and such and such. And no, he said, who are you looking for? I said, I'm looking for this address. I said, who are you looking for? And I told him who I was looking for. He said, they live right back there. And I went back there. And I thought, God, how easy it is to go from 60 to hit a brick wall and be stopped in the tracks. Not because of anybody else, but because of ourselves. And this guy, he's this Pharisee, and asked Jesus to come in, but he saw this woman, he saw this going on, and he stopped right there and he said, hey, look, wait a minute. Don't he know if he was a prophet? Now, he just saw the miracles. He just saw the signs. He just saw the wonders, but his flesh got into the way. If he knew who it was, who was behind him, if he knew this sinner, if he knew this person that was behind him and how sinful she was, because she shouldn't be touching him anyway. Amen. Shouldn't be touching him anyway. If he knew who was to touch him, he would have done something about it. And Jesus flipped it around because he knows the thoughts of every single person. The word of God says he did not trust any man because he knew what was in man. And Jesus flipped the script on him. He didn't tell her to stop. He didn't. And the woman kept crying and kept crying and kept washing his feet and trying scrubbing it and scrubbing it and scrubbing it. Because in my spirit, as she was washing his feet, she was seeing her sin. And she knew she should have been stepped on. She knew she should have been nothing. She knew she was nothing, but she kept scrubbing and she kept weeping and she kept crying. God, please forgive me. Please, Jesus, help me. I don't know about you. I don't know about you. I'm just talking about myself. Please, Jesus, forgive me. Please do something for me just to have a touch, Lord, from you. Please don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Please. Oh, to taste and to see and for God to use you and then for it to be taken away from you. Please, Jesus. Please. She didn't have that luxury. The only thing that she knew was that love was right in front of her. And she could not get that love. She could see everybody else receiving the love. She saw everybody else receiving her. She saw everybody else receive the love of God. But the love was there. And she could feel a faint warmth of the love of God. But she couldn't get it. It wasn't going in. She couldn't receive it. The effects of trivial sin. Jesus began to flip it on him. He said, and Jesus answered him and said, Simon, I have something to say to you. And he replied, say it, teacher. He said, a moneylender had two debtors, and one owed 5 denarii and another 50, or 500 denarii and another 50. When they were unable to pay, he graciously forgave them both. So which of them will love him more? And Simon answered, he said, man, I suppose the one who he forgave the more. And he said to him, you have judged correctly. And turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, do you see this woman? Do you see her? And she don't stop. To me, she does not stop wiping his feet and crying because she's in another place. She has totally tuned everybody out, and that's the thing that we need to do. We need to tune everybody out when it's our time with God. So much, Jesus. There's so much piety in the church. And the thing about it, it says, turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered into your house and you gave me no water for my feet. But she has wept. She has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but she, since the time I came in, has not ceased from kissing my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she anointed my feet with perfume. For this reason, I say to you, her sins, which are many, have been forgiven. For she loved much. Now, I want you to get that. And I want you to understand something. Jesus said, Simon, which one? I want you to explain something to me. You have one that had 500 and the other one that had 50. And it's there after forgiveness takes place, after the debt had been washed away, afterwards, who's going to love the most? He said, the one that owed the most. But right here, the word of God says that she loved first. She recognized the one that loved so many. It says it in the word of God that she loved first, that she love, because it says right here, for this reason I say to you, her sins, which are many, have been forgiven, for she loved much. He didn't say that she forgave. He forgave her first. But she fell with that faint presence of God. She fell in love with the Savior. She fell in love with the Savior first. She saw him. She saw him from afar, and she knew all that he had done. She saw his kindness and his mercy and the grace of the Father flowing through him. She fell in love with him. And she loved him. She was going to hell, but she loved him. And she washed his feet, and she took all that she had, and she bought all that precious, precious gift, and she broke it. And it smelled up the whole house. She anointed it, and she kissed it. And Jesus said to her, your sins, which are many, are forgiven. Because you love much. Hallelujah. You look and the thing about it, it says, well, where do you see about trivial sins? My heart is broken. Because I'm so afraid for the church today. I'm so afraid for the body today. Because we jump and we run. And we don't know the anointing, the preciousness of who we feel the anointing. But do we bathe in the anointing? Do we hunger and thirst for the anointing? Or do we just have that feeling and we don't carry the anointing and the abiding anointing of Almighty God because of piety? You say, well, what do you mean because of piety? You know, it says right here, it says in the 48th verse, then he said to the woman, your sins have been forgiven. And it says those who were reclining at the table with him began to say to themselves, who is this man who even forgives sins? And he said to the woman, don't worry about them. Don't worry about what they're saying. Don't worry about the looks that they're giving. Don't worry about the looks that they're giving me. And he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Praise God and hallelujah. He said, your faith has saved you. Your tears, your love brought you to me. The Holy Spirit brought you to me. You than the love that you had. Gave you that hunger and you came in where you shouldn't have came in. You did what you shouldn't have done. You broke the traditions of man, but you came and you knelt down and you laid yourself down at my feet. You love much. Before I even forgave you, before I even set you free, before the Father poured his grace and mercy upon you, you love much. But were you talking about this trivial sin, the effects of trivial sin? Well, see, if you look over in Psalms, the 57th chapter, in the 17th verse, if you look there and you put your finger right there, you'll see this, and it says, the sacrifice of God are a broken spirit, and a broken and a contrite heart. God, you will not despise. If you look at the Message version, it says, going through the motions does not please you. This is what they're talking to God. Going through the motions does not please God. What are you talking about going through the motions? Well, if you look in Luke, the 18th chapter, you see the situation concerning a Pharisee. And oh, tax collector, oh, sinner. See, sometimes we put on a Pharisee's hat. We don't put on a Jesus hat or Jesus clothes. We put on Pharisee's clothes and we look so nice and we go through the motions. You know, I long for the days and that, you know, I wish that you didn't have to look a certain way and this and that. But that's the way that it is, and I've learned that. But anyway, nevertheless, we go through the motions, and we go through things, and I'm looking so, and I have my appearance, and I have everything put together. My hair is just right, and everything is perfect. If you look at the Pharisee, we got our Pharisee clothes on. And as we come to the altar, and we see this old, dirty, nasty old tax collector. It came and extorted me last week. He charged me more than what I should have should have been charged, but I had to pay. He took away from me what was mine, but I had to pay me. I know that he's crooked. I know that he ain't nothing but old sinner. I know this, but we are going to the same God, the same altar. And as they both go to the altar, God pulls on that old tax collector, pulls out on that old sinner with cords of mercy and grace and love. And he pulls on. The Holy Spirit pulls on him and it begins to beat his chest. And it begins to cry out with a broken heart and a contrite spirit. God, forgive me, please. God, please. Please. Forgive me. Have mercy on me, Jesus. Please, Jesus. And then you got this old Pharisee that looks and he sees all of his buddies around. He sees all his partners around. He sees his family. God is trying to pull on him. God is trying to move on his soul. And he looks up to God. He looks at an old tax collector. And he sees him snot. And he sees him acting unseemly. Acting out of sorts. He's not acting the way he's supposed to act. He's at the altar of God. The church is live and it's happening. The Spirit of God is flowing free. He should be acting a certain way. But you don't know where he's been. You don't know his heart. But he's beating on it. And instead of saying, come on, man, dig in a little deeper. Come on, man, dig in a little deeper. Come on, man, dig in a little deeper. You're almost there. Come on, man. And we should be cheering on when they come to the altar. We should be cheering them on. Come on. You can get in. You can get in. But we see it and we look and we say, oh, Jesus. Can none of us yet. But this old Pharisee, he looks at the old tax collector. Look this at the old sinner. Look this old, whatever he may be, whatever sin it is, looks at it. And he says, God, I thank you that I'm not like this old tax collector. I thank you that I'm not like this old heathen. I thank you. I fast twice a week. I pay my tithes. All that I require do, I do, and I thank you that I ain't like him. But tax collector beat on his chest and ripped his clothes. And unwilling to lift up his eyes, he began to weep all the more. Don't that sound familiar? Don't it sound familiar like the woman that washed his feet? Don't it sound familiar? There was a time in your life that you should have came to God like that. Or the time in your life that you should have came to God ripping out your clothes and tearing your clothes and tearing that old Pharisee garment off and humbling yourself to God. God, I'm broken. I need you. Not caring what nobody else was saying. Not caring what anybody else was doing. God, I need you. Please help me. Both of them. Both of them. You say, well, I did come to God like that. Well, I'm asking you this question. What's going on right now? What's wrong right now that we don't have a broken heart or a contrite spirit? What's wrong right now that it's all hot to Todd? Oh, look at me. And I got it all together. Who cares if you got it all together? You have it all together. Thank you, got it all together. Look at them, they're getting on my nerves. Look at them, look what they're doing. Look at them, you're going to hell. You got that attitude. You're going to hell. I don't care if you speak in tongues. I don't care what you do. You're not going to make it in. You're not going to make it in. There's no thankfulness. He's going through the motions. Playing the game doesn't please him.
It is a flawless performance. It's nothing to you, God. As I learned God worship, when my pride was shattered, my heart was shattered, heart shattered lives ready, ready for love. And it says, God, don't for a moment escape your notice. It don't escape God's notice. When we are so hot to Todd, look at me, and we forget about the loss. Forget about where we're at. That's the whole thing about it. You don't get it. People don't get it that it's the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the gospel. But what do you mean the gospels? The gospel is you. It's you. It's what God has done for you. So we're so caught up in everything else, we forget about the gospel. What God has done for me, I remember the gospel when he saved my soul. When I went up and I said, God, I just want to do whatever you want me to do. And I finally gave in and he gave me that word, John 3:16. I had nothing else, but oh, I knew that God loved me. I knew that he loved me and I loved him. I knew it. Because my sins were great and they're still great today. I feel so unworthy of God's presence, of all that he has done in my life. I fall short every day. But oh, Paul said, when I am weak, then he is strong. And God wants us to understand that. A broken heart and a contrite spirit. And it says, the thing about it is if you look at the woman, if you look at the woman, if you look at her, you see that he has shed a broken heart and a contrite spirit. And the message says, ready to receive, open to receive the love of God. And she received the love of God because love covers a multitude of sin. And then the love of God washed all my sins away and washed her sins away. And we forget. And we forget. And it's so saddening and somewhat sickening that we forget. We forget what God has done for us. We forget about his great mercy and about his great grace. And God, forgive me for I fall short so much. And I ask you to forgive me that are on this Zoom call, please. But God is so wonderful. He is so good. Her sins were many, and she received the love of God because of a broken heart and a contrite spirit. And the thing about it, God sealed her. Jesus sealed her with peace that surpasses all understanding, that they could not, the enemy could not destroy the salvation and the thanksgiving that God had just given her. What about us? What about us tonight? What about us? Oh, that we would have a broken heart. That we keep our heart broken before God. That we would have a humble spirit before God. For Paul said, Paul had all revelation, all this power, and he kept saying, God, without you, I'm nothing. God, my best is filthy rags. God, please, please don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Please, Jesus, whatever you want me to do, I will do. Please, Jesus, I'll go to the worst of the worst because I was the worst. See, we forget about the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's a good news for what he has done in your life that has to be shared. You got to stand up on a chair and say, look what God has done for me. Look what God has done. Look what God has done. Look what he's done for me. You know something? It's awful strange. It's awful strange to me. And this just crossed my mind and just dropped in my spirit. Oh, Zacchaeus was old tax collector. He was old tax collector. And the one that was at the altar was the old tax collector. Golly. And old Zacchaeus, it didn't say that Zacchaeus got saved when Jesus was with him. It says Zacchaeus got so happy, man, when he heard Jesus was coming by, climbed up in that old tree because he was short. Zacchaeus climbed that old tree and Jesus saw him. Jesus got so much warmth in his heart. He said, come on, Zacchaeus, come on down. I know what's in your heart. I'm going to eat at your house today. I wouldn't be surprised if that old tax collector got saved at the altar. It was old Zacchaeus that said, I'll never forget what he had done for me. You know, I believe as children of Almighty God, we have forgotten. We have forgotten where God has brought us from. We have forgotten we was the one that was out in the street. When we looked down, there was on the ones that was in the street. And we looked down on the ones that were selling themselves for a drink, for a smoke, for a sandwich. And we looked down on them when they crossed our pathway. The ones that's getting high and drinking, smoking, or cracking. We look at them now when we look down on them. The ones that had no food. We look at them and we say, oh, they look like they got food. And we look down on them as Holy Spirit moves upon. We have no compassion, or we temper our compassion. We turn the knob that I have compassion on who we will have compassion on instead of who God has compassion. Jesus said, come unto me, all ye who labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He didn't say who, or black, or white, or Republican, or whatever. He said, come unto me, all ye. If it's a preacher and he's backslidden and hurting, come unto me. If we love him just as he loved us. It makes no difference who. It makes no difference who. But we make a difference. It make a difference. I ask you tonight that you would thank God for what he has done for you. I ask that you would go on your prayer closet as your food is in the oven. I ask that you would go and that you would dust off the gospel of your life. That you would dust it off. That you would go to the altar. And be honest with God. Say, God, I have not fasted twice a week. I have not paid my tithes. I have cheated you in so many ways. I had 1,000. I gave it 2 pennies. You have blessed me greatly. I shortchanged you with my time and my talents and all that I've given you. I have been slothful and lazy. I've seen them dying and go to hell, but I did not throw them a rope. I threw them a piece of floss, expecting them to catch hold of a piece of floss that could not be seen in the snow. And I said, yes, I have done all that I can do. God, I have robbed you, I have cheated you. Please have mercy on my soul. I ask you to restore her right spirit within me. I ask you to please forgive me and make all things. And I thank you for your great love for me. Please let the gospel of my life shine so others can see, and I will tell them. If nothing else, I will tell them of what you have done. So many are going down and going to hell. And all they need is the gospel of your life. With thanksgiving. Not with attitude. Not with presumption. Not with nerve. But with thanksgiving.
I ask you to go to your closet. I challenge you to go to your closet and say, God, please work your work. Please have your way. Please forgive me. I'm not doing it for show. I'm not doing it for show. But I'm asking you, and I'm going to pray for you. And we're going to pray for the need. I'm going to pray because it's in my spirit. And I don't want you to do it because the pastor asked you. But I want you to do it because the Holy Spirit is going to draw you into that place. Because the presence of God is falling where you are right now. And I'm going to ask you to move in your life. But God wants the gospel. He wants the gospel of your life to shine. That's what he wants, the gospel of your life to shine. And you begin to move in thanksgiving every single day. Brother Titus was right. Every day is a day of thanksgiving because we're thankful for the gospel of Jesus Christ, that gospel that has moved in my life. God, I'm thankful. You could have left me alone. You could have left me on that old back view. You could have left me in my sin. You could have left me even after I went in the ministry and was born again. I went in the ministry and I failed. And I failed. God, you could have left me. You could have left me. You had every right to leave me on the wayside. You had every right to leave me alone. You had every right. But you was that old Samaritan that came by when others shook the head and wagged the finger. You were the one that came by and got a hold of me. Got a hold of the old sinner, backslid. Got a hold of me. Came and said, I can do it again. I can do it again. And I said, please, Jesus, please, one more time. Just one more time, please. Please, just one. Please. What about you? He wants the gospel to be seen. He wants you to walk in thanksgiving. And the key of walking in thanksgiving every single day is be so thankful for the gospel of Jesus Christ and what it's done in your life. And be truthful to God. Take off your Pharisee clothes. They need to be burnt up in the fire today because they're chaffed and it's a bondage. And God just wants you to be real with him. He loves you today. He loves you. Going through the motions doesn't please God. Doesn't please him. A flawless performance is nothing to you. Talking about God. And then he says, I learned God worship. I learned God worship when my pride was shattered. That's when I learned. Heart shattered lives, ready for love. Don't for a moment escape the notice of God because he loves you so much. I'm going to pray for you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, come to you. Father, you are all that I have. You are my everything. And Father, in the name of Jesus, I come to you. And Father, all that I have is you. Now, Father, in Jesus' name, you told me to pray this, and I'm asking you that your Holy Spirit that drew that old tax collector, and you're no respected person that drew that old Pharisee. And Father, it drew that old woman that was full of sin. It drew her to the Pharisee's home. And you also drew that Pharisee, old Simon, you were drawing him, Father, to the cross. Now, Father, I ask you that same anointing of love,
and mercy and grace. You said you cannot come to God, come to the cross, come to the Jesus, unless the Holy Spirit draws. So I ask you, Holy Spirit, that you would go to where each, every one of them is. You would draw them to you. Draw them to the place of refreshing. Draw them to the cross, to the place where you loved them first so much. And they loved you like the woman that washed your feet. They loved you and had such excitement concerning what you had done, just like old Zacchaeus that got saved at the altar. And he was so happy. They were so happy and thankful for all that you have done. Father, I ask you to draw in Jesus' name and that you would move upon our heart in the name of Jesus. That our hearts will be broken, that our spirits will be contrite, and we would be able to receive the fullness of the love of God that you have for us. Father, I ask you to move, not by power nor by might, but only by your Holy Spirit. And I thank you, Father. I bind the enemy from whispering in their ear. I bind every distraction in the name of Jesus and every hindrance. And Father, I ask you to bind what I have bound. And I loose the pure stream of the love of the Father through Christ Jesus into their home, into their closets, and into their lives, and into their hearts. And I ask you, Father, to make all things new, that they could receive the fullness of the love of God, like old Zacchaeus and like the old woman that washed his feet with her tears and poured out her life upon his feet. And Father, we thank you, because right then and there, her life was a sweet fragrance. That's what you want our life to be, a sweet fragrance that fills the room and lets all know that there is hope. Jesus lives, and I have the gospel. I have the gospel for what he did for me, he can do for you. And I thank you, Father. Now, Father, we lift up the needs in the name of Jesus, and we ask you to meet every need. We ask you to glorify yourself, and I just give you the praise. And Father, we thank you. And Father, I ask you in the name of Jesus that they have such a sweet and a wonderful thanksgiving, and I ask you to move. And let us see the hearts as you see, feel what you feel, and let us enjoy one another in you, in Jesus' holy name. Father, I ask you for the blood of Jesus over the doorposts of their lives and over their homes. Keep all safe that are on this call and now all those that are out of Outreach Christian Fellowship in the name of Jesus. Keep safe with the blood of Jesus in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen and amen. God bless you. I'm glad that you joined the service. I hope that you was blessed. I love you. God loved you so much more. I want you to please remember that there's victory in Jesus. Amen. I love you. I'll see you Sunday. Have a wonderful Thanksgiving. Brother Titus, I will see you before Sunday. Amen. All right then. God bless you.